Tyne Tees Television, Channel 8.
It's January 1959, and on City Road in Newcastle, a new regional television station is born. Now, after 46 years, Tyne Tees Television is moving house. Goodbye, City Road. Hello, Television House. Further up the Tyne and across the water in Gateshead. I'm Andrew Friend. I used to be a reporter and a presenter at Tyne Tees, and some say I used to be a bit of a fun guy. But for the past few months, I've been part of the project group at Tyne Tees, trying to move an entire television station from across the river in Newcastle to the Metro Centre here in Gateshead. And it's been a bit of a nightmare in parts.
I'm Skibby, that's how everybody knows me here. Formerly engineer, but now one of the senior technical coordinators on this project for Tyne Tees. One of my main responsibilities will be to take the new technology to the journalists, who used to work with paper and pen, but now it's all computers and all this new technology that they're going to have to use and use every day to produce the work that they do.
Well, my name's Graham Tate, so I'm a heavy duty cleaner here. Been here 12 years nearly. This is my boss.
I'm Dave Fishburne. I've been here for 13 years. I'm in charge of the heavy duty lads. We do anything from cleaning toilets, mopping floors, to moving furniture, filling skips, moving everything. Anything that you want shifting, we're the ones to shift it.
Now, this isn't just any typical office move. We're not talking about moving filing cabinets or paperclips. In fact, we're leaving everything behind. This is a completely new place to work and a completely new way of working. It's quite a revolution. But it's also quite emotional for some people because they've spent their entire working life at Tyne Tees at City Road in Newcastle. Bob Herrick started at Tyne Tees 6 weeks before it opened the City Road studios, when the average age of all the new recruits was 26.
Basically, it was a run-down warehouse with one or two attached buildings. It was hard to imagine it as a television studio. We did work almost on a building site, trying to get all our equipment sorted out and treading planks everywhere. In fact, it got to such a state that 24 hours before Harold Macmillan was due to come and open it, the front reception was a complete shambles, all bricks and timber and everything. But they got the panelling up overnight, and in good showbiz tradition, all went well.
A few months ago, Tyne Tees was once again another building site. But this time, a purpose-built studio is being created. While new equipment's installed and staff are trained and transferred, the show must go on back at City Road.
The old site at City Road is basically a very old building which doesn't lend itself to modification. It's very corridor-y, little places, and what we needed was a big sort of open area where we could put a lot of the new technology in and let people work in a more open office environment. So purpose-built is much better because we can get on with the build here and continue to operate at the old site too.
Turn to transmission 9, 8, 7, 6. Beating one, roll. 4, 3, 2, 1.
On air. Every programme made and much of the material shot has been kept in the library at Tyne Tees.
We were told that the library was going to get moved, all the tapes were going to go into Studio 5, so we had to come in one weekend to move the whole lot. 22,000. And then we've got the whole lot to move again.
We've got to box it all up and take it to the watermark.
Yeah, over to the new place, but it's all got to be in sequence. Uh-huh. Fun and games.
Today, the tapes are laid out, ready for the move. The floor is awash with memories from the people behind the programmes. Meet Betty Bage, who joined Tyne Tees in 1964 as a secretary in the film department
it was full of chaps, 31 chaps and me, and every time you walked past the film department, everybody either groped you in those days or had a cheeky word to say about what you were wearing and everything. So I used to learn to be as cheeky back to them, and they were always playing jokes. They packed me off one time in a cardboard box, and actually four of them carried me down to the post room. The building had a life of its own. It sucked you into it, and everybody had something to say or do in it. People's romances were born here, and they fell apart, you know, affairs were brought. I mean, I myself was courted and dumped, I was married, I was divorced. Loads of people like that. And the building itself, it could echo loads of stories all around the place. Everybody just got to know everyone. Some of the marriages are still going now. It's a kind of
magic. The magic of television in those days was such that people used to come along to City Road, come to the studios, and they used to expect to see where the horses were kept on programmes like Bonanza and the Ponderosa. They thought the horses were kept up the back lane beside the scene door.
Children came round with carrots and things like that, and we said, well, what are these for? So the horses, where are the horses, mister? Where's the stables, mister? So we'd just shown a western, and they assumed that the big Tyne Tees white building would have the stables somewhere.
Tyne Tees reigned supreme over the quayside when it looked like this. Making programmes about the region, as well as supplying ITV nationally, often meant weeks working away from home.
My name's Dave Dixon. I started at Tyne Tees when I was 18. When I first started on film crews back in 1971, there would sometimes be 8 or 9 people who would go out on a crew. In addition to the director and production staff, the basic crew consisted of 5 of us who worked together all the time. Crews stayed together for many years through thick and thin, and there was a really strong bond between us all. It was like the family, and if we told jokes, it became a bit like the joke society. We would just reel out a number. We didn't have to tell the joke. Everybody knew what the joke was. We had such a close bond that at one point we actually bought premium bonds together and convinced that we're going to stay together forever and a day. We still have those bonds, but we haven't won yet. Nowadays, it's perfectly common to turn up with just a cameraman who does camera and sound and a reporter, and that's it.
It was like a family, certainly. You would go to the canteen, and the gossip, the jokes, the stories, the talking about the work, everyone was so professional and so keen to do the job properly, it made everything worthwhile.
Gavin was one of many who made their names working on the Tube. But City Road was all singing and dancing well before the 80s.
When people talk of rock and roll coming, they always say it was the Tube, but there were programmes before that. Young at Heart, I remember Jimmy Savile wearing pointed-toed shoes, and of course he had to have everything larger than everybody else, and they were about 8 inches, so he had to walk up the steps backward to get in.
Keeping in with the neighbours was always important to Tyne Tees. The local pubs even served as studios, but time and tastes move on.
Could I have a sparkling mineral water, please, landlord?
And Tyne Tees is moving on. New technology and money-crunching priorities meant over the years the staff numbers dropped by 800. About 170 staff are moving to the new site. In an industry of big egos and creative types, that's what's politely called a challenge.
They can never make up their minds what they want and what they don't want. There's always a time factor involved, and that time factor always goes out the window, and we're always left at the sharp end of it.
Like, what was it the other day, the other week? Newsroom?
Yes.
All these CDs, get rid of them. So we started to get rid of them, and all them ones over there, you can get rid of them. So we started to get rid of them, what happened? Oh! What are you doing with them?
Back, please.
Oh, well, no, you can't throw them out. We need them. We need them. We're still here, so we still need them. Wait, what do I do with the 4 bags I've already got? Oh, I get rid of them, but leave the rest of them. And, you know, so you're told one thing, then you're told something else completely different.
Working to a deadline is all part of the job, but this is the first time everyone at Tyne Tees shares the same deadline. In order to meet that, we have to run two newsrooms, one to transmit the daily news and the other to train staff on new equipment which will completely change the way we work.
I'm finding it very, very hard. It's a totally new way of thinking.
People are anxious. I think it's just it's a fear of the unknown, as with everything that you don't see. There are a lot of people whose new roles within the company are now encompassing things they've never done before. And a key part is getting the training done so that they feel comfortable with what they're doing.
July the 2nd is crunch time, when everyone and everything has to be up and running smoothly, ready for the first news bulletin from the new building. What are the chances, lads?
No, it's definite until the minute we're told. But this is it.
Can you imagine that?
You'll be told to do something one day, right? And then you go to say, June, we're going to do this job. Oh, no, that's been cancelled. You've got to do this instead. And that's a last-minute notice.
We're supposed to start there, then to there, then to there, then to there. And then they go back to there again. And we're in what the Americans would call a no-win situation.
But all that uncertainty is nothing compared with what's to come.
All of a sudden, just heard an almighty bang. Oh, and the lights have just went off. This has been happening all night. We've had one calamity after another all night.
When people at the top decided to move Tyne Tees Television after 46 years, it was down to people at the bottom to make it work.
I think if there have been any major problems, it's lots of little ones in one big lump, really. It's the logistics of the whole thing. Trying to fit everything into the same timetable. When do we bring the cameras in? When do we install the set? When do we bring the desks in? How do we move the desks? Do we take the old desks from the old place? No, right, we'll buy new ones. And when do we put people in? When we fit them into the offices, all that sort of thing. When we put the knobs on the doors, you name it, it's got to be thought about and it's got to be put into the timetable. And that's the nightmare. That's when you wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning and think, did I do that?
The hard bit is just trying to remember everything you've got to. I constantly walk around with little slips of paper and I find these stacked up my office every day. I think, oh, I must do that again, I must do that.
As soon as the new gear is working, staff have to learn how to master it.
Where is that drop shadow coming from? So what's generating it?
That's up here somewhere, isn't it?
Yes.
So the running order is a little bit different. We've still got the page number, the presenter's initials, the title of the story.
Up until now, reporters have handed their scripts and material to a skilled editor who assembled it ready for transmission. Now, they'll have to put it together themselves.
Yeah, it's not quite as bad as I thought it was going
to
be.
No, we don't want to put this off on the video, just on the audio.
Go and talk to one of the stars.
The basics of it, I wouldn't say simple, but once you get your head around it, you work a way of in your head, how you can operate it. But if you get too cocky with it, if you get, you know, too confident, and you forget to do something along the line, you can find yourself at an end point and think, oh, my God.
I've done something wrong now.
That's much better.
Very nervous, because you haven't had an editing background. And it's a totally new skill, so very nervous, apprehensive.
So we turn off the track light on V1.
Come a bit slow.
Need that as well, really. Right.
We do have a lot of fun, like, honest. Don't worry. Especially when it's 4 o'clock and it's time to go home.
High tech, low tech, it's all a bit of a struggle.
Graham, whenever we've been given a job in the past, we've always had it done on time or we've had it finished early. We've never failed yet.
More by accident than design, though, Davy Lake, you know.
No, once, planning.
When you get the... if we're allowed to build ourselves.
I plan from our side.
If somebody leaves, we're allowed to get on with it. It's all right, like, whenever you ever leaves, we're allowed to get on with it, for f***ing sake.
That's true.
Hello.
Hello, cleaners.
Cal, another training exercise, isn't it?
Aye. Somebody keeps on changing the mind.
With 3 weeks to go, things are getting fraught.
This is Studio One, which is being soundproofed. However, as you can see, it's a little bit of a mess at the moment. Hopefully this will be ready by tonight. Ready for full rehearsals next Tuesday. I think we're a little bit behind doing this, so... But the boys will stick in and it'll all be marvellous.
Tonight?
This morning, Gillian, over in 85, was saying that the rubbish that they had was a fire hazard. And I got to call, I've got to sort the fire hazard out, but I can't because the bins are full. So what do I do? The only thing I can do is move the fire hazard from one part of the building to another one. Now I just think it's a bit of a... mess.
The printers aren't working, the computers are switched off, the wrong paint has been laid on the studio floors, the set's slightly out of kilter, therefore we can't put the cameras in, the acoustic linings and the soundproofing. The studio is about 6 weeks behind schedule. But I'm told by someone who was there at the start in 1959 at the old place that the concrete wasn't even dry when they went on air, so I'm a bit fed up, but fingers crossed.
Absolutely befuddled. I think it's just a mush in there.
We've had to extend the training. We're going to have to come in on weekends now and catch up. And we're going to have to catch up for July the 2nd.
If it's not ready, you're fired.
I just don't know how on earth you did what you just did. I mean, I'm no expert, but you just...
Look, if there's a hard way to do it, I'll find it.
The schedule is really, really, really tight. If one thing slips, then lots of other things slip. You've really got to keep to that schedule.
But things are slipping.
They are slipping. That's why when we didn't design work on a weekend, we're going to have to design work on a weekend, and the overtime bill's going to hit the roof. But that's not the only thing to hit the roof. In a weekend of soaring temperatures, tropical storms and flooding, Tyne Tees turned into its own disaster area.
Well, I was looking forward to a nice, relaxing weekend, but I got a call on Saturday evening to say there were three substantial water leaks in the newsroom of the new building, the aircon had packed in, and that the room where all the electrical gubbins was running at 55 degrees Celsius. It was probably just about meltdown point. 24 hours later, same guy rings me from City Road to say that there'd been a huge flood, water pouring in from the roof of Tyne Tees, and from the drains. The place was absolutely awash.
It looked like an underwater spring. The water was just like gushing everywhere. In the meantime, I was getting phone calls off members of the staff throughout the building to say there's water coming through the ceiling.
It's being converted into a swimming pool.
There was water coming everywhere to a lot of highly sensitive areas, through the control room. Just everywhere, there was ceiling tiles falling all over the place. I thought it was World War III.
So frantic phone calls and trying to set up a transmission from our Teesside studio for first thing Monday morning for GMTV bulletins. 5:15 in the morning, I get a phone call. There's been a power failure at the Teesside studios, the first time in 13 years.
I think it is a building now. It knows it's going to be closed down and get pulled down, so that's what's happening now. Everything's gone to
pot. So we've had meltdown, floods, and a power failure in about the space of 28 hours. I really do think we're jinxed.
Always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath.
On July the 1st, the sun set on Tyne Tees at City Road.
Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true.
Today we finally turn off the lights for the last time in this grand old building on the banks of the Tyne at City Road. So we thought we'd ask a few of our colleagues from around the building to join us and say cheerio. Open a cork and there they are, folks. Cheers to City Road and goodbye to City Road and cheers to everybody.
And when the sun rose on the new studios, tired and emotional staff revved into action. just to help reduce the tension, the boss arrived.
I'm a little bit nervous now. I just want to get on and do it, really.
Always look on the light side of life.
Although everyone had practiced and worked hard on dummy runs,
everything's in your contract.
There's something you forgot.
Screwdriver.
With live telly, you can never be quite sure what's going to happen.
Time to transmission 9, 8, 7, 6. 5 to transmission 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Hello and welcome to the new home of ITV Tyne Tees at Television House in Gateshead. First is lunchtime. Detectives are investigating after a woman's body was found in her home. 28-year-old Jacqueline Stabler was discovered late on Thursday night in her bungalow at the Brooms in Euston in County Durham.
Tyne Tees weather with BMIBaby.com, the airline with tiny fares.
2, 1, 0. Fantastic. You just got to keep it going for another 25 years.
We're there, we did it. Fantastic.
Just to get that first one away, you know, one down but thousands more to go, but just to get that first one away. And I've never been so excited about a 4 minute, 16 second bullet in my life.
No comment.
Got there.
So what's your next job?
Two-time Bolton.
And keeping it going for the next 46 years.
Yeah.
It's great to be here today. It's excellent to see everybody's managed to pull it together and make it all happen. I wish I was young enough to be part of it, you know, to have this new beginning.
There's a new generation coming in. It's encompassing all the new technology. And if they have as good a time in their 40 years as we had in our 40 years, then it's got to be good.
If I was coming to this building as a young person starting my career in television, I'd be so excited. I think it's brilliant. I've actually now forgotten the old building. I have, honestly.
That's it! Come on, you groovy disc jockey. Better get this rubbish off now.
Always look on the bright.